Good morning. So let's start our discussion on the 10th session on module 5. That is, we had to speak about the applications of the 555 timer. In the previous class, we had discussed about the basic block diagram and internal construction of the 555 timer. What are its various pins and their usages? So in this class, we'll be able to analyze and design two important applications of the 555 timer. One is as the monostable multivibrator, and the second one is as astable multivibrator. We had already spoken about what is the difference between astable, monostable, and bistable multivibrators, the three types of multivibrators. A multivibrator is a circuit which can have more than one level of output. If a circuit generates an output having two levels, it is a multivibrator. In an astable multivibrator, there are no there are no stable states. Okay, as you can see here, and both the states are quasi-stable state or semi-stable state. Both these output states are quasi or semi-stable state, and hence it is also known as the free-running oscillator or the free-running multivibrator. Whereas a monostable multivibrator has one stable state, that is the zero state, and one quasi-stable state. Whenever it has to change from zero state to the quasi-stable state, an external trigger input is needed. When a trigger is given, it will change from the stable to the quasi-stable state. And finally, the bistable multivibrator, which needs two external trigger inputs because both its states are stable states. And it can change from one state to another only when a trigger is applied. So from 0 to 1 also, an external trigger is needed. From 1 to 0 also, another external trigger is needed. So the question in monostable multivibrator can be to explain the operation of how 555 timer works as a monostable multivibrator and derive the relevant equations with waveforms. And you may have problems for designing the circuit. So now coming to the circuit diagram of a monostable multivibrator, it looks something like this. As you can see here, you have a resistor and capacitor connected externally, and this resistor and capacitor junction is connected to both pin 7 and pin 6. As you can see here, the junction of R and C is connected to both pin 7 and pin 6. One end of R is connected to pin 8 or VCC. The one end of C is connected to ground. And an external input trigger is applied to pin 2, which is the trigger input pin. And you observe pin 8, which is VCC, is connected to the VCC of plus 5 volts. You can give any voltage between 5 to 18 volts. And pin 4, which is the reset pin, is used to bring down the output from high to low in between its timing cycle. If we don't need to use it, we have to connect pin 4 also to VCC. That's what is done here. Pin 4 is also connected to VCC. Pin 1 is the ground pin, as usual, connected to ground. Pin 5, we know, is the control voltage pin. When we want to change the timing cycle, I don't want the comparison voltage at the upper comparator to be 2/3 VCC, but I want something else. Then I will connect an external voltage at pin 5. But when I want the comparison level at the upper comparator to remain as 2/3 VCC, you just connect a capacitor from pin 5 to ground. That capacitor helps in overcoming noise variations. Any false triggering due to noise and other things that can be avoided through that capacitor. Okay, so no other external voltage is connected here. Output is seen at pin 3 as usual. Now, the same thing we have shown by showing the internal diagram of the 555 timer. As I told you, it has three 5K resistors connected between VCC and ground. You can see 5K, 5K, 5K. So the point of intersection of the lowest 5K with the second one generates a reference voltage of 1/3 VCC, which is given to the non-inverting terminal of lower comparator, and a voltage of 2/3 VCC, the total voltage across two 5K resistors, which is 2/3 VCC, is given to the inverting terminal of the upper comparator, as you can observe here. Now, the external trigger input is connected to pin 2, which is the inverting terminal of the lower comparator, and an external resistor and capacitor, this R and C, which we have shown, is connected between VCC and ground. And the junction of this R and C is connected to both pin 6, which is the threshold pin. You can see this threshold pin is nothing but the non-inverting terminal of the upper comparator. And it's also connected to the discharge pin, the same point, which is the collector of transistor Q1. You see this discharge transistor Q1, its collector is available as pin 7. And the emitter is connected as ground. It is connected to pin 1. The base of this transistor is connected to the Q bar output of the SR flip-flop, the complementary output. And instead of reset pin 4 being directly connected to the reset of the flip-flop, as I told you before, here it is a PNP transistor where the reset pin is available as the N terminal of the transistor, and you can clearly see this N terminal has been taken to VCC, indicating that I am not going to forward bias this transistor. Unless and until I connect this N terminal to ground, remember the emitter is already at a positive reference voltage. Okay, the P-type emitter is at a positive value. So if you connect the n-type base also to a positive value, this transistor will remain off. For now, I want the transistor to remain off. So we'll just keep this pin 4, the base of the transistor, connected to VCC. And as usual, we have Q bar connected to the inverting power amplifier, and the final output is seen at pin 3. So this is the internal diagram. Let's analyze the working of this circuit here. So what happens initially? So let me say initially, voltage across capacitor, let me call this as voltage across capacitor, is zero. So there is no voltage across the capacitor initially, and VC is zero. So you can see you just remember this is a jump here. Capacitor is not connected to pin 2 in monostable. So what happens here? I'll say the external trigger is also not connected, with external trigger also not given. Not given means I can say it is at high. The trigger voltage is high, and it is. So the voltage at inverting terminal is more than voltage at non-inverting terminal in the lower comparator. So what will happen to the output of the lower comparator? Output of the lower comparator will become zero. Hence, the output of lower comparator becomes zero, because here the voltage, the trigger should be a low going trigger. Remember that. Usually, if this remains at high, then it is more than 1/3 VCC. So you will have inverting terminal voltage more than non-inverting, and output of this comparator will be zero. What happens to the upper comparator? The upper comparator inverting terminal is at 2/3 VCC. The non-inverting terminal is at the capacitor voltage. You see, threshold pin, pin 6 is connected to the capacitor. So the capacitor voltage, which is zero, will be applied here. So initial value of capacitor is voltage is zero. So what happens again? Here output of upper comparator will again become zero because non-inverting terminal is at a lesser voltage than inverting terminal, which is at 2/3 VCC. So what happens if both the inputs to the SR flip-flop is zero? The output will remain in the previous state. So whatever was the previous state, whether it was a one or zero, output will try to remain in that state. So let's assume the previous state is a zero state. I'll assume this previous state is zero, okay? So output remains at zero state because that is the stable state of the output. Please remember, the stable state of the output is the zero state. So output continues to remain in the zero state. Now, when we apply external trigger, what happens? Now, I am going to apply an external trigger input. And how is that trigger going to look? It will be a negative going pulse or a low going pulse. From high to low, it's going to come. And it will remain in that low state for a very small duration of time. So you're going to give a trigger something like this. It will be at 5 volts and it will come down to 0 volts. But it will remain in that 0 volts for a very short duration of time. What happens when I apply this trigger? Momentarily, when the voltage here at this edge, when it becomes less than 1/3, as soon as the voltage in this trigger input becomes less than 1/3 VCC. See, it is becoming less than 1/3 VCC when the trigger input edge is going below that 1/3. From high, it's coming low. Okay. As soon as it comes to less than 1/3 VCC, what is happening? Positive terminal is at a higher voltage in this lower comparator. Negative terminal is at a lesser voltage. So this will change to 1. Output of the lower comparator will change to 1 whenever the external trigger is applied. So if this becomes 1 now, what happens in the upper comparator? So the upper comparator is monitoring the capacitor voltage. And one more thing what you should see, if this was at 0, all the voltage would have been, remember, when the final output is zero, this would have been one because this is an inverting power amplifier. Yes or no? So this transistor would have been on and everything would have been discharged. Now, as the capacitor is completely discharged, and since this output has come to one state, that means what will happen here? When the set input is high, irrespective of the reset, let's say the reset will be low because the capacitor voltage was still zero. So the reset input here is still low. So this is in 1-0 condition. S is 1, R is 0. So the output Q will be 1 and Q bar will go to 0. So Q will be 1 and Q bar becomes 0. Which means this transistor will be off. Okay. So now the transistor is turned off, which means this capacitor will now try to start charging from VCC. So this capacitor will start, a current will start flowing from VCC through resistor R into the capacitor C, charging the capacitor towards VCC. Okay. It will try to charge the capacitor towards VCC now because the transistor is off. Now, as the capacitor voltage increases, So as long as the capacitor voltage is less, so here as long as it is less than 2/3 VCC, the output of upper comparator will remain zero only, because this is at 2/3 VCC. And what will happen to this? The trigger pulse for a short duration, the input trigger, which was less than 1/3 VCC, has appeared and it has gone back to high state. That means here the input value will again increase above 1/3 VCC. So after trigger is removed, after this trigger pulse is removed, the voltage here will remain at more than 1/3 VCC, which means this will again go to zero. So this is in 0-0 state, which means the output will continue to remain in the previous state. So the previous state of the output was zero. Output has continued to remain in that state. But what has happened when this was in set state? This Q bar was zero, but the final output was high. So you see the output would have changed to high whenever the trigger has passed below 1/3 VCC. So we said whenever the input trigger goes below 1/3 VCC, the output changes from low to high state. And the output will continue to remain in the high state even if this trigger went back to high. See here, the trigger has gone back to high state, but in spite of that, the output will continue to remain in high state, because Q bar will continue to remain in the previous state, that is the zero state. And this transistor is switched off only. When will this transistor switch on? When Q bar becomes 1. And when will Q bar become 1? If the upper comparator output changes from 0 to 1. And when do you think that will happen? When this non-inverting input of the upper comparator exceeds 2/3 VCC. So whenever this non-inverting input, which is nothing but the capacitor voltage, so whenever VC just exceeds 2/3 VCC, then the other end voltage is at 2/3. So this changes from 0 to 1. The upper comparator output becomes 1. The lower comparator output is at 0 itself, because the trigger input is at logic high. It hasn't gone low. Only one trigger we applied and we removed it. So that means this is at high only. So this output is 0. So this is 1, this is 0. In the sense, the output will be reset. 1 will change to 0 and Q bar will change from 0 to 1. And when Q bar becomes 1, what will happen to the final output? The final output, when this becomes 1, it will change to 0. You will see the output goes to low state. Even when the external trigger is in high state, the output has automatically come down to its low state because of the action of the external capacitor in the circuit. And what is happening here? You see here, this Q bar, which changed from 0 to 1. Now, Q bar has come to 1 state, because Q has gone to 0. Q has gone to 0, so Q bar has become 1. If Q bar has become 1, this NPN transistor Q1, the discharge transistor, will switch on. So this discharge transistor will get sufficient base emitter voltage whenever the base is at logic 1. Okay, it's a high voltage, so this NPN transistor switches on. And where do you think the collector of this transistor is connected? It's connected at the capacitor junction only, RC junction. So now what will happen? This capacitor will try to discharge through this transistor. You see, this capacitor tries to discharge through this transistor because this transistor is now on. So it is providing a low resistance path. Remember, a transistor that is on has very low on-time resistance. So it will provide a very easy low resistance path for all the capacitor voltage to discharge. So a current will flow through this from pin 7, from capacitor to pin 7 and then to ground. Hence, remember the capacitor which had started charging when the output changed from low to high. The output changed from low to high when the external trigger became less than 1/3 VCC. So when the external trigger became less than 1/3 VCC, the output changed from low to high, and that's when the capacitor started charging from zero towards VCC. But the capacitor voltage will not be allowed to reach VCC. Remember, the capacitor charges exponentially. We know that equation. So as the capacitor voltages reaches the level 2/3 VCC, what we see is happening, the transistor is switching on and the output is going back to low state, which means all the charges of 2/3 VCC gained across the capacitor will be discharged. So the capacitor discharges, and remember the discharge time is not such a large exponential as charging, because the discharge is happening through a very low resistor on transistor of a very, very low resistance. So the discharge is happening suddenly. You'll see almost a sudden fall in the capacitor voltage from 2/3 VCC to zero, and the capacitor voltage will continue to remain at zero. How long? So again, the output has reached its stable state. Output went from the zero state or the stable state to quasi-stable state or the one state when the external trigger went below 1/3 VCC. Okay, we used a pulse which will go below 1/3 VCC. And after that, even if the pulse was removed, the output changed from the quasi-stable state back to the stable state after this capacitor started gaining the voltage more than 2/3 VCC. So once the capacitor voltage exceeded 2/3 VCC, the flip-flop conditions changed and the transistor, discharge transistor, was switched on, and the capacitor will start losing its charges. And that's when the capacitor voltage falls to zero, as the output voltage will also fall to zero or the stable state. So this will remain in this stable state until and unless I apply the next trigger pulse. Only when I give a second trigger pulse, you can make the output change from zero to one again. And again, that capacitor charging and discharging cycle, everything will repeat. So whatever we study, it will repeat itself when the second trigger pulse is given. So for every input trigger pulse, the output changes from zero to one once, and it will remain in that one state for a fixed time duration. We'll find out how RC determines that time duration next, and it will come down on its own to the zero state or the stable state. So this is about how the monostable multivibrator works. Let's try to derive an expression. Before that, we can see the waveform much more clearly here. You see the trigger pulse is at VCC usually. It is brought below 1/3 VCC or less than 1/3 VCC for a very short duration of time, after which it is again taken back to logic 1 VCC. So when this comes down, I know the output changes from zero state or stable state to quasi-stable state. So its output is changing from zero to quasi-stable, and the capacitor which was at 0 volts will start charging towards VCC. But the capacitor is allowed to charge only till it reaches 2/3 VCC, because the circuit action will be in such a way that the output will switch over from high to low, or it will come back to its stable state as soon as the capacitor voltage becomes 2/3 VCC. So what happens then when the output comes down back to the zero state? The capacitor voltage will also come down to zero state, and it will discharge suddenly because it is discharging through a transistor that has very low resistance. Hence, this is the waveform. we are supposed to determine the width of this pulse. The width of this pulse, also known as T on, it will be decided by the values of R and C, which are connected. So let's recall the capacitor charging equation. The voltage across a capacitor is always decided as V final, the final voltage to which the capacitor can charge, not the voltage to which it actually charges, but the final voltage to which the capacitor can charge if allowed. That is V final. V initial is the initial voltage across the capacitor. So V initial minus V final into e to the power of minus t by RC, where RC is the external resistor and capacitor which we have connected in the circuit. Now, with this equation, we can determine an expression for this pulse width or the pulse time T on. We can also call it as TP. Okay. So one thing you observe here, this capacitor can charge up to VCC if it is allowed. Okay. So this will be the V final voltage in this circuit. The final voltage for the capacitor will be VCC because it has the capacity to charge until VCC if allowed. So let me try to substitute in this equation. The voltage across the capacitor VC of T, I'll just keep it as T, is the final voltage, which would be VCC. If allowed, it would reach VCC. Plus, what is the initial voltage across the capacitor? It is 0 volts. So 0 minus final voltage VCC again into e to the power of T by RC. So minus T by RC. I've just substituted for V initial and V final. Now, let's try to simplify this equation. And I will consider at T is equal to TP or at T is equal to T on. So if this is 0 time and if this time is T on or TP, at T is equal to TP or at T is equal to T on, what would be the capacitor voltage? That is called instantaneous capacitor voltage, denoted as VC of T. So this is the instantaneous capacitor voltage. Okay. And this capacitor voltage at the end of the given pulse width has reached a value 2/3 VCC. So you see for the left hand side, I'm substituting 2/3 VCC because this capacitor voltage has reached that voltage level. On the right hand side, we have VCC and this is minus VCC into e to the power of T by RC. Okay, this is T by RC. And if I shift this VCC or 2/3 VCC to the right hand side and minus VCC e to the power of minus T by RC to the left hand side, I'll get this as what? 1 minus 2/3, which is 1/3 VCC. And VCC on both sides will cancel. We have VCC on both sides. And this 1/3 is obtained as 1 minus 2/3. That is your 1/3. And on the other side, you'll have e to the power of minus TP by RC or T on by RC. So here it should be TP or T on because we are checking at the time T is equal to TP or at T is equal to T on. Okay. Now, let's simplify this by using natural logarithms. So we can apply natural logarithm on both sides. So if I apply ln of e to the power of minus TP by RC, I'm going to get ln of e to the power of minus TP by RC is nothing but what? Minus TP by RC into 1. Natural logarithm means e to the base e. So this is minus TP by RC into 1. And here on the right hand side or on the left hand side, I have ln of 1/3. This will be, what will it be? This will turn out to be TP on the other hand. If I remove the negative sign, I will have Tp will then be equal to ln of 3. Otherwise, it would have been ln of 1 by 3. So Tp will turn out to be ln of 3 into Rc. So Tp by Rc would be ln of 3, and Tp would be ln of 3 into Rc. How much is ln of 3? It would be 1.1. So the pulse width in the monostable circuit is decided by the value of resistor and capacitor which we connect externally, and that multiplied with 1.1. Okay, so please remember this equation. You will have to use it for the design. The pulse width is 1.1 RC. Okay, and the complete circuit diagram of a monostable multivibrator or one shot is shown. This is the same simplified circuit diagram without showing the internal diagram. Here I had shown you the complete internal diagram. Yeah, this one. This circuit what we have on the left hand side, it's the same circuit what we are drawing here. Okay, so we are just calling the resistor as RA and the capacitor as C. As usual, 6 and 7 discharge pin and threshold pin are shorted and connected to the capacitor. Then what is this? Pin 1 is grounded. Between pin 5 and 1, we have a capacitor of 0.01 microfarad, and that is to eliminate noise. Trigger input at pin 2, output at pin 3. VCC is pin 8 and reset pin is pin 4. The same circuit diagram what we have already considered. Now, let's draw a graph by considering what would be the value relationship between the resistor, capacitor and the timing delays which is generated. If you notice, the time delay that is generated is drawn on the x-axis starting from 10 microsecond, 100 microsecond, 1 milli, 10 milli, 100 milli, 1 second, 10 seconds. So we are ranging from 10 microsecond to 10 seconds. And on the y-axis, we have the capacitor value, the capacitance C ranging from 0.001 microfarad to 100 microfarad. We have shown the variation. And the resistor value is shown as a variant. It's like as though I'm using a potentiometer for the resistance. So the resistance value you're fixing here, 1K. And for capacitor ranging something around 0.01 microfarad to capacitor ranging to 100 microfarad, we are varying the capacitance, keeping the resistance fixed at 1K and showing from where to where the time delay changes. The time changes from 10 microsecond to almost 100 milliseconds when the capacitor changes from 0.01 to 100 microfarad. Are you following? See, it's just finding the slope of this first curve. See here. So what does this indicate? This indicates a change in timing from 10 microsecond to 100 millisecond. The timing would be 10 microsecond if capacitance is 0.01 micro, and the timing would be 100, the capacitor would be 100 microfarad, then the timing would be 100 milliseconds. So this is change in C from 0.01 micro to 100 micro, which causes a change in time, from 10 micro to 100 milli. That's all. All these curves are for fixed resistances. And they show how if I change the capacitance, the timing delay can change. So we have drawn these curves for fixed values of resistance, 1K, 10K, 100K, so on. Okay. So this is another easy way. If I know I have a 10K resistor, see, for example, the second curve here, second from the top, you have a 10K resistor and I'm using a 1 microfarad capacitor. Then automatically I can bring it and draw a perpendicular to this timing axis. And I know I'm going to get a timing delay of 10 milliseconds. So your capacitor it's a little more than 11 milliseconds exactly. See, you know that TP is 1.1 RC. If your R is 10K and your capacitor C is how much? 1 micro. So here capacitor C is 1 micro and this is 10K. You'll get around 11 milliseconds as the pulse width, the time duration for which the pulse will remain in the high state or the quasi-stable state. Okay. So that's about, and in a practical laboratory implementation of the monostable multivibrator, to avoid false triggering of the output, I want to make this pulse duration shorter. Remember, if I use a pulse wave or a square wave, if you use a pulse and if this width is larger, that means this the pin 2 will remain at less than 1/3 VCC for a longer time. So see, for example, a situation like this. This is your trigger input and you need the output time duration is less than the trigger in time. So this trigger was low for this amount of time. Okay, let me call it as TP. Whereas the TP pulse width is lesser than this time. Now, what happens? Once this timing cycle is completed and the output has come back to stable state, this trigger input is checked and the trigger input is again less than 1/3 VCC here also. So what will the monostable assume? It assumes that the trigger is low and again it will send the output back to high state for another timing cycle. It has finished one TP. For a second round of TP, it will immediately send the output back to high state. You'll just see one glitch here for it coming down and going back to high state. This is called false triggering. I wanted an output time which is much lesser, but you're getting almost double that, because the input trigger has remained low for a longer time. So this can be prevented if I differentiate this trigger pulse. For that, I'm using an RC differentiator or an RC high pass circuit. This is also an RC high pass filter. We have spoken how a C and R here will act like a high pass filter. And what will it do to a square wave? A square wave will be converted to what? It will be differentiated. A high pass filter will always differentiate the square wave if you choose right values for R and C. Okay. So it is going to generate a very narrow trigger pulses which resemble impulses. So it's almost like generating one impulse here, one impulse here. So for every positive edge, one positive impulse, and for every negative edge, one negative impulse. So this kind of short-term trigger pulses will be generated because of this RC network to which we can connect the input trigger to avoid false triggering, as I mentioned. And one more thing is, since it is generating a positive trigger and a negative trigger, I am interested in a negative going trigger, a trigger which will drop from VCC to less than 1/3 VCC and go back. So since we want only negative going triggers, what will I do? I'll connect a diode here, which will pass on all the positive triggers to VCC. So this will pass on all the positive triggers to VCC because of the diode like this. This diode will be on whenever this end is positive and it will conduct all the positive going trigger pulses will be sent in this direction. And only the negative going trigger will come on the input like this. Hence, false triggering can be prevented in the practical implementation of the monostable multivibrator, which is normally done in the lab. We use an RC high pass filter along with a diode to allow only short duration negative going trigger pulses at pin 2. Okay, please remember that. Now we will take a small problem. So in the circuit shown in this figure, RA is supposed to be 10 kilo ohms and the output pulse width is to be 10 millisecond. Find the value of C. It's a direct problem. Here you can just say, we know this pulse width is 1.1 RC or RA into C. RA is given, you're supposed to find C. So C will be TP divided by what? 1.1 times RA. TP is 10 milliseconds. So 10 into 10 power 3 divided by 1.1 into RA is 10K, which means 10 power 4. You will get something around 0.909 and the closest available value will be 1 microfarad. So this is one type of problem. Alternatively, you can be asked to design a monostable multivibrator. Okay, a monostable multivibrator for a pulse width of 1 millisecond. Let me say you have to design the values of R and C. In this case, you can just assume C. Let C be 0.01 microfarad. Therefore, find R. R will be what? 1.1. See, what is the pulse width? It is 1.1 R into C. And we have assumed C. So you can find R as, let's say, TP divided by 1.1 C. So if the TP which you have assumed given is 1 millisecond divided by 1.1 into, we have assumed capacitance as 0.01 micro. So you can easily compute this and find what would be the corresponding resistor. So this is a design problem. This is a value based problem where one element is given and you're finding the other. Okay, so this completes our discussion about monostable multivibrators. Let us consider the summary of this class. So at the end of this class, the student should be able to analyze and design the working new monostable multivibrator using the IC555 timer. And let us consider how we can simulate the same circuit in the lab using multisim software. So I'll be showing you the demo of how to simulate the monostable multivibrator using multisim. Let us consider this circuit to be rigged up in multisim. Good morning. Let's consider the simulation of monostable multivibrator using 555 timer. So as usual, I'll open place component in the multisim. Once you open multisim, we can choose various groups. Let me take sources first. I am interested in DC power source. Okay. Then we are interested in ground. Okay. If you want, you can place two or three grounds and later you can use. Next, I am interested in basic resistor. We need, for a design of 1 millisecond timing period, I need around 900 ohm resistor, which won't be available. So let me take 820 ohms, one resistor, and another of, let's say, 82 ohms. So approximately we are going to get 900. Then I need a capacitor. Okay, same thing in basic capacitor. Let me choose, you can just type what you want here in the component. I want 0.1 micro one and 0.01 micro. let's just say place. And once we are done with all resistors and capacitors, we need to go to a mixed family or mixed group, their timer. Let me take the first one, LM555CM. Okay. So now I am done with everything. I'll close this place. Now we'll connect the various, just drag and bring it here. I'll do Control R to reverse the direction. Okay. And I'll connect VCC to pin 8. And let's bring one of the grounds and place it here. And I can connect the negative of the supply to ground. And I know pin 4 should also be connected to VCC. If we don't want it to have any separate effect, then let's bring these two resistors. Switch directions. Let me connect in series. And I want to connect it to the VCC. And to this, I should connect this capacitor. Change the direction, the other end to ground. Ground also to this pin 1. These things we can connect. Now the junction of these two points, pin 7 and pin 6 should be connected to the same two points. And we should give an external trigger input at pin 2. And this last capacitor to be connected between pin 5 and ground. So let me connect this. Okay. Only if there is a wire, it will connect. Now we'll take signal sources. Here, function generator I will use. I'll connect the function generator to this trigger input. Remember, monostable multivibrator requires an external trigger to help change its output from the stable state, that is low state, to the high state. So we have to connect this, and I'll copy this ground and place it. The other end of the signal generator is grounded. Choose a square signal. Let me take something around, say 500 hertz. Duty cycle, I want a very small negative time duration. So let me keep the duty cycle as 90% or 95%. Amplitude 10 volts peak, okay. So when once all this is set, you save it and you can connect the CROs. Actually, there is a four-channel oscilloscope here. See here, four-channel oscilloscope that I have dragged and placed it here. This is the four-channel oscilloscope. And once we are done with everything and saved it, let me run the simulation. And I'll click on this four-channel oscilloscope. Can you see the input trigger? I had changed the color to yellow connection to the oscilloscope. This is the upper one represents the input trigger. The second red colored one represents the output waveform. With every negative going edge of the, for every negative going edge of the input trigger, you see the monostable output will change state from low to high. It will remain in high for a fixed duration, which is decided by R and C. And afterwards, it will come back on its own without the trigger to ground or the stable state. Only with the next trigger, it will go back to high state again. And what is shown in green is the capacitor waveform. the capacitor you can see will again start at 0 volts and it will reach a voltage level up to 2/3 VCC as we discussed. And then it will suddenly discharge to ground. You see a straight discharge path. It will suddenly fall to ground once its timing cycle is complete. Once the upper comparator gets 2/3 VCC as voltage across the capacitor, it will automatically reset because the output will also change state. So if you want, you can move this. See, in this 4-channel oscilloscope, you can choose which channel. Third channel C, 5 volts per division is the time scale. I want to move the position down. So I'm just bringing this capacitor waveform down. So you can see all the 3 waveforms separately here. This is designed for 1 millisecond, I told you. You can move this cursor if you want to measure the time. See, the cursor at this starting of the output timing cycle, it's at around how much? 0.7 millisecond. 709 microsecond means 0.7 millisecond. Now I'll again move this cursor. 1 second. Its position has changed. Yeah. To the ending of timing cycle, it will be around 1.6 or 1.7. So 1.69 is around 1.7. 1.7 minus 0.7, it's around 1 millisecond. So the time duration, if you want, you can make it hold and you can stop the simulation and do the measurements. So I've just stopped the simulation. Let me start taking the measurement from this point. It is 2.66 milli. And let me see the end point. 3.6 milli. So it's exactly 1 millisecond. The pulse width has been 1 millisecond. The capacitor charges from 0 to 2/3 VCC in that 1 millisecond. And with negative going edge of the input trigger, the output will be changing state. Okay. So this is about the working of monostable multivibrator. Hope you all understood. So let's continue in the next class.